I'm to talk about John Wycliffe this morning, this afternoon. Dr. Kaufman advises me that there are seven different ways to spell Wycliffe, and all of them are correct. Wycliffe and Wycliffe, I want to say Wycliffe using the Y as a short vowel. I may very possibly lapse into Wycliffe, and if I do, you can smile. Now, I am strategically placed at the beginning of this lecture series. The esteemed Dr. Kaufman will be coming behind me, and so all questions that you have when I have finished, of course, would be directed to my superior, and I would humbly defer to him, affording you the opportunity to glean from his mind the riches that he has. Did I get myself off of the hook? I hope so. John Wycliffe, the morning star of the Reformation. Wycliffe has been dubbed the morning star. The aptness of this designation is highlighted by Stephen Nichols, who said, "The term morning star has been alternately used to refer to either the star Sirius or the planet Venus. It appears brightest in the pre-dawn, the time when darkness still dominates, but also the time of promise, the time of the promise of the dawn and the rising sun." Maybe I should repeat that, because it sets the whole tone for who Wycliffe was. The morning star appears brightest in the pre-dawn, the time when darkness still dominates, but also the time of promise, the time of the promise of the dawn and the rising sun. So, John Wycliffe is situated historically between the darkness and the morning light. And with that pictorial background, let's spend a few moments with the life of this very remarkable man. The Western world remained in the clutches of the Middle Ages, complete with feudal lords and a supporting lower class. Thought processes were molded by the Roman Church, which was mired in a leadership crisis, a liturgical bondage, and spiritual darkness. Latin remained the language of the church, and since it was unknown in an English-speaking world, it rendered worship unintelligible to the common man. Likewise, the scriptures were chained by this distant language, forcing dependence upon the clergy for understanding of the truth. In 1190 AD, the church had authorized the sale of indulgences, allowing for permissive sinning. And in 1215, the doctrine of transubstantiation, the idea that the elements of communion become the literal body and blood of Christ, that doctrine was adopted, as well as mandated confession to the priest, confession of sins to the priest. Through infant baptism, clerically authorized marriage, required mass, and last rites, the door to heaven was owned by the church, and there was an entrance fee. Across the channel from continental Europe, the British Isles were a microcosm of this stifling world situation, and yet beneath the surface, change was in the offing. Politics were volatile. Holding the salvation of all men in their hands, the church had assumed the power to require a nation, a sovereign nation, to forward vast amounts of money to the treasuries of Rome, while at the same time occupying extensive areas of national acreage for monasteries and their supporting industries. Some estimate that the church held at least a third of all available land in England. The situation was complicated by the fact that England had engaged the French, yet again militarily, as a part of the Hundred Years' War. leaving the national treasury impoverished while the church prospered at the expense of the nation. To say the least, English nobility was just a little bit nervous. Language was changing with the emergence of the middle class. A vital avenue for communication was being normalized. The Renaissance was dawning, an era of scholastic learning and appreciation for the emerging arts was awakening in the sterile intellectual environment dominated by church clerics. Students with a desire for learning were challenging the status quo, and England was becoming a center for intellectual pursuit. It seems that in 1167, all English students had been evicted from the University of Paris. As a result, that the University of Oxford was formed, and it would soon become Europe's leading university, and her halls would be open to new thought. So St. Paul's pregnant phrase, in the fullness of time, would find new meaning in the Celtic world turned Anglo-Saxon. And at the center of this providential movement was John Wycliffe. He was born in Yorkshire, England in 1324. That's a variable date. You can look other places and see that date shifted one way or the other. That appears to me to be license for all of us who are graying just a little bit, just to shift that date one way or the other and be perfectly consistent with church history. At the age of 13, he apparently didn't have a cell phone, didn't need to play video games or text anyone, so in lieu of something to do, he decided to go to Oxford University. There, the study of theology had begun to blossom under the godly influence of Bradwardine, and the young student would imbibe the intellectual and spiritual climate of an emerging institution. While there, his theology would be touched by Christian experience. In 1348, Europe and subsequently England was blasted by the effects of the Black Plague. It was estimated that half of English population died under the power of this scourge. Wycliffe was deeply affected. A Reformation historian records that, quote, this visitation of the Almighty sounded like the trumpet of the judgment day, end quote, in the heart of this young Oxford scholar. And feeling his desperate need, he studied the Word of God while fasting and praying in order that he might find refuge from an angry God. Wycliffe's conversion is dated to this experience. And I want to stop here just long enough to say that sometimes in retrospect, we strip the Reformation era of vital Christian experience. And that's hardly fair. Theology was the primary issue because theology had been lost in the clutter of the temple. But if we are to believe that the Holy Spirit guides us into truth, and if we are to believe that people that seek God will find him, then Wycliffe is on a first fruits of people who, even today, attend liturgical churches, and some of us would glance askance at their intent. And yet, wherever people seek God, he will be found of them. So don't strip the Reformation of Christian experience in lieu of theology. It is not an either and. It's not an either or. It's a both and. Wycliffe is an excellent example that after days of fasting and prayer, this Oxford scholar would find a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. From his earliest years as a student, he was a brilliant scholar. And even his enemies agreed that he was the flower of Oxford. His studies covered a wide range of disciplines. He seems to have ignored underwater basket weaving. In the interest of the law of optics, chemical analysis, psychological genesis of sleep, geometrical rules, and national economics. In 1356, he graduated from Merton, the oldest college in the Oxford system, which had graduated the saintly William of Ockham and would produce T.S. Eliot and later McAlister McGrath. In 1360, he earned a master's degree, and in 1372, he would obtain a doctorate in divinity and at that time was considered Oxford's leading philosopher and theologian. Prior to his doctoral degree, 1366, he became a chaplain to the king. Although as a cleric, he was expected to conclude church theology matters in the interest of the church or Rome. In that same year, the King of England was ordered by the Pope to provide required funds to the church. Seems the church is always short of cash. He was required to provide funds from the national treasury, or he was to appear in person in Rome to give an account for himself. Wycliffe advised the crown that the Pope was supreme in matters of faith, but he had no power to interfere in the policies of a sovereign nation, speaking directly to the issue, as was generally his style. He declared, there cannot be two temporal sovereigns in one country. Either Edward is king or Urban the Pope is king. We make our choice. We accept Edward of England and we refuse Urban of Rome. It would be the beginning of a life of controversy, to say the least. We at this distance do not appreciate the control that Rome maintained over the Western world. The Pope felt himself to be superior to any ecclesiastic, any political authority. So what he has done is rather significant. Would be the beginning of a life of controversy, but also the beginning of a life of influence. Not only was he an advisor to the king, but his opinion was heard in the halls of Parliament. This political influence was appreciated by his local magistrate and lord, John of Gaunt, who would provide Wycliffe political protection from his governmental and clerical enemies. In addition, He retained a teaching position in the Oxford community where he was a primary influence among students. It's amazing how God can position his people when it's time. A church historian observed that he spoke as a master to the young theologians at Oxford, and having such authority in the schools, whatever he said was received as an oracle. It would be impossible to estimate the wholesome influence which he exercised over the minds of the students who attended in great numbers at the time. To most, he was a man greatly admired and emulated. And someone has provided a verbal portrait which sets him in clear focus. His knowledge of the scriptures, the purity of his life, his unbending courage, his eloquence as a preacher, his mastery of the language of the common people rendered him the object of general admiration. As such, his reputation as a defender of truth now spread beyond Oxford. The King of England appreciated his integrity, while Rome took note and feared his pen and his influence. As Wycliffe's interest shifted from politics to theology, he became increasingly suspicious and even hostile to the influence of the Pope and the policies of the Roman Church, though he always considered himself a faithful son. Interesting, Wesley always considered himself a faithful son, though there would have been people in-house that probably would have argued about that. By 1377, Wycliffe had sufficiently annoyed the Pope that he was summoned to appear at St. Paul's Cathedral in London before the papal representative, the Bishop of London, to answer for his opinions. As he came, pictures have been made, and from those pictures we draw the following visual of him, because there were no cell phones to snap him as he went in. A tall, thin figure, covered with a long, light gown of black color, the girdle about his body, the head adorned with a full, flowing beard, exhibiting features and sharply cut, the eye clear and penetrating, the lips firmly closed in token of resolution, and the whole man wearing an aspect of lofty earnestness, replete with dignity and character. Friends of the Oxford scholar discouraged his compliance with the Pope and his summons, but his response was simple: "I am ready to defend my convictions even unto death. I have followed the Scriptures." Upon his arrival, the bishop instructed that he must not sit down, rather criminals stand before their judges. Not exactly innocent till proven guilty. Wycliffe did not appear alone, but rather in the company of two very powerful political friends. The atmosphere was tense as civil and religious stood toe to toe with obvious disregard for each other. The tension was not lost on the bystanders, and the meeting was aborted due to the uproar among the populace. But 3 months later, the Pope issued 3 papal bulls against Wycliffe and his work, calling him the master of errors, and ordered his publications banned or burned. 1378, he summoned to Lambeth to meet church representatives and perhaps would have been convicted of acts against the church, but for a hasty intervention by the Queen Mother, recommending and effectively forbidding sentence to be passed. At this time, the papacy suffered a very tremendous embarrassment. The office of the Bishop of Rome, understood to be the successor to St. Peter and the head of the Church of God, was claimed by not one, but 2 candidates who simultaneously claimed to be infallible, and each excommunicated the other. Wycliffe, who had become increasingly disillusioned with the administration of the church from the papal throne, now took the ultimate step of proclaiming the whole Roman system as anti-Christian, and further declared that the Pope was, in the language of 2 Thessalonians 2:4, the man of sin who exalteth himself above God, end quote. Hardly a way to win friends and influence people with the Roman legates. Perhaps under the strain of his workload and the pressure of high-placed opposition, he fell sick and his death was anticipated. When such good news reached the representatives of the church, they hurried to his bedside to receive his anticipated recantation before his death. They were disappointed. Not only did he not accommodate them by renouncing his faith, but he proclaimed confidently, "I shall not die but live," and again declared the evil deeds of the friars. Indeed, he did live, and his controversy with the politics and theology of the church in Rome only increased in intensity. Wycliffe decried the wealth of the church, saying Jesus and the disciples had ministered without regard for material possessions. In a tract entitled De Ecclesia on the nature of the church, he declared that the church invisible was the only true church and that Christ alone was the true head of that church and not the Pope. His language is majestic. Christ is the true man and true God existing from all eternity. At his incarnation, he united both natures in his one person. His grandeur is incomparable as the only mediator between God and men, the center of humanity, our one only head. Wycliffe further denied the necessity of an intermediary confession of sin, declaring that that practice was not approved either by Christ or the Scriptures. He decried indulgences by saying, "Will then a man shrink from acts of licentiousness and fraud if he believes that soon after, with the aid of a little money bestowed upon the friars, an active absolution from the crime has been committed can be obtained? He crowned his problems in 1380 when he challenged the heart of the Roman system by denying the doctrine of transubstantiation. In a tract entitled On the Eucharist, he called the miracle of the Mass, the doctrine of transubstantiation, he called it the veritable abomination of desolation in the holy place. Now, if you're familiar with scripture language and that phrase, you know that's high noon as far as rebellion against God is concerned. A veritable abomination of desolation in the holy place. Incidentally, the Roman church has not changed that theology. No human, he said, can recreate the literal body of Christ. Rather, the Lord Jesus is to be received spiritually by faith in the Eucharist with no dependence upon the words of the officiating minister. What a put down to the priest. How canst thou, O priest, who art but a man, make thy maker? What? The thing that groweth in the fields, the ear that you pluck today, would be your God tomorrow? As you cannot make the works which he made, how can you make him who made the works? Woe to the adulterous generation that believes the testimony of Pope Innocent rather than the gospel. Those are strong words. And at this point, the venerable scholar lost the support of his protector, John of Gault. Wycliffe's writings were burned and his friends deserted him. The tide had turned. In 1382, he was forbidden to teach at Oxford. Sad but not despondent, he declared, the truth shall prevail. And he withdrew to a pastoral living in the village of Lutterworth. But Wycliffe had not been merely a protester. It's important for us all to know that you can't build anything on what you're opposed to. But the moment that what you're opposed to, as you get the upper hand, then you have to believe in something. And too many of our churches have discovered that way too late. They found great satisfaction in opposing things. But when it came their turn to build, they were ill-prepared. Wycliffe had not been merely a protester. In 1378, he was instrumental in commissioning young men known as Lollards who traveled throughout England proclaiming the centrality of Christ and the Word of God. Wearing no shoes, covered with ankle-length russet-colored gowns, they became familiar sights in the narrow streets and byways of their English homeland. The Lollards even had their Wittenberg door moment, nailing a petition to the doors of Parliament's Westminster Hall in 1395. These poor preachers, as they were called, extended Wycliffe's influence well beyond his lifetime and even on into the British Reformation of the 16th century. By 1379, if not before, Wycliffe had become absolutely convinced of the authority of Scripture. And at this point, we're going to engage a word that is still making ripples in theology. Scripture, he says, is infallible. Other teachers, even one so great as Augustine, are liable to lead into error. If there were 100 popes and all the friars were turned into cardinals, that's a position in the Roman Church, their opinion ought not to be acceded to in matters of faith, except insofar as they base themselves on the Scriptures. Further, he was convinced that it was not sufficient for him and other scholars to possess the Word of God alone. The average man of the street must have his own Bible in his own language to read and study for himself. Wycliffe declared Christ and his apostles taught the people in the language best known to them. It is certain that the truth of the Christian faith becomes more evident the more faith itself is known. Therefore, the doctrine should not only be in Latin, but in the vulgar or common tongue. And as the faith of the church is contained in the Scriptures, the more these are known in a true sense, the better. The laity ought to understand the faith, and as doctrines of our faith are in the scriptures, believers should have the scriptures in a language they could fully understand. Amazingly, particularly to us, this that we take for granted was opposed by the church. In the 1200s, the Catholic Church had decided we forbid the laity to possess any of the books of the Old and New Testaments. Having any of these books translated into the vulgar or common tongue, we strictly forbid. Wycliffe thought otherwise. Joined by the students from Oxford, he began the laborious process of translation, transcription, and publishing. He did not know Greek or Hebrew, but he did know Latin. And so his translation would be taken from the Vulgate as translated by Jerome. How much actual work was done by Wycliffe himself is unclear. And that's been debated for a long time. F.F. Bruce made the statement that he did it all since that time. But he had his hand in it sufficiently that antiquity assigns the credit for the book to Wycliffe himself. We know that he was ably assisted by Nicholas of Hereford and John Purvey. And by 1381, the first complete New Testament in the English language was available, and the Old Testament completed in the next 5 years. Not only were the scriptures translated, but his gift to the English people extended to the formulation of English prose, which continues to this very day. While the peasant held his New Testament close to his heart, the church fumed. By this translation, the scriptures have become vulgar or common, and they are more available to laymen, and I love this line, and even to women. That must be the ultimate, I don't know, even to women who can read, that they were, then they were, I'm sorry, let me back up, I got it. Involved with the commercial. By this translation of the scriptures have become common, and they are more available to laymen and even to women who can read than they were to learned scholars who have a high intelligence. So the pearl of the gospel is scattered and trodden underfoot by men. Later, the Bishop of Arundel would complain, "This pestilent and most wretched John Wycliffe, of damnable memory, a child of the old devil, and himself a pupil of Antichrist, crowned his wickedness by translating the scriptures into the mother tongue." By 1382, the distribution of this newly translated scripture began in earnest through the efforts of the intrepid Lollards. They would be mocked, attacked, imprisoned, and killed. But the seed was planted. Wycliffe had no illusions about their fate. He told them, "Trust wholly in Christ, rely on his sufferings, and be aware of seeking to be justified in any other way than by his righteousness." In 1383, Wycliffe suffered his first paralytic stroke. In the following year, he died on December the 31st as the result of a second stroke suffered while officiating communion before the high altar in Lutterworth. He was buried just outside the church, the resting place accessible from his chair beside the high altar through a small door now called the Wycliffe door. Perhaps I don't need to tell you this, but I want to tell you this, that I have stood beside that sacred place in abject awe. I wish I had time to tell you, and if you asked me, I would, but that's all right. Wycliffe's earthly journey was over. His work was done. But the light of the morning star shone far. It is believed that the description of the parson from the prologue of Chaucer's Canterbury Tales is Chaucer's tribute to Wycliffe and his reform efforts. It certainly is a picture of a faithful pastor, if not a reformer. But the light reached further. Among his students at Oxford were Bohemian students who took his ideas back to Europe and circulated his tracts on the continent. And among those influenced was a young scholar named John Huss, whom the Council of Constance would condemn to be burned at the stake. Huss, influenced by Wycliffe, was cited as the origin of Martin Luther's errors as well. And Wycliffe, though dead, continued to speak. And among the followers of Huss were people who became known as Unitas Fratrum, or United Brethren, from which the Moravians would emerge. And the Moravians were prolific missionaries before William Carey, and it was Peter Bowler, a Moravian, who led Wesley to understand salvation by faith. Wycliffe continues to speak. Thus Wesley stood on the shoulders of the Moravians and Luther, who stood on the shoulder of John Huss, who stood on the shoulder of John Wycliffe. While it is true that Wycliffe evaded martyrdom at the hands of the church, his mortal frame did not completely escape their clutches. 40 years following his death, the Council of Constance met, seeking desperately to squelch the truth that Wycliffe had released to the world. It was a rather imposing gathering. The Emperor of Germany, 20 princes, 140 counts, a pope, more than 20 cardinals, 7 patriarchs, 20 archbishops, 91 bishops, 600 other prelates, and about 4,000 priests met to crush the work of John Wycliffe and stem the rising tide of liberty which flowed through the floodgates he had opened wide. In a fit of desperation, they condemned the deceased. Is that a good line? You like that line? They condemned the deceased. You never know. They condemned the deceased and his writings posthumously and found him guilty, deceased, of heresy and crimes against the church while he lay peacefully in the grave. They further ordered that his bones be exhumed and burned as a statement of public repudiation of this heretic. After some unexplained delay, the bones were removed from their resting place and burned, with his ashes thrown into the nearby River Swift. The picture is prophetic. Thomas Fuller captured the moment when he said, "The brook Swift has conveyed his ashes into the Avon, the Avon into the Severn, and the Severn into the narrow seas, and the narrow seas into the main ocean. And thus the ashes of John Wycliffe are the emblem of his doctrine, which is now dispersed the wide world over." They have indeed spread. You know his name and spirit through the translation efforts of Wycliffe Bible translators, who have painstakingly and diligently conveyed the scriptures to the nations and tribes of the entire world. From an academic enclave behind scholarly walls along the River Thames to a minimum of 3,200 languages spoken in hut and hovel, the work of Wycliffe lives on. He labored in a time of theological and spiritual darkness, shackled by the very church whose mission it was to save the world. His enemies were men of the cloth in league with the superstitions of imposed ignorance. But Sunday's coming. The sun would rise in the brilliance of Wittenberg's light. But before that moment of truth would be fully known, God gave the world a portent of his redemptive purposes for mankind through the faithful labors of his servant, John Wycliffe, the morning star of the Reformation.